The Wildcat was an unsung hero of World War II. In the war's early days, it was the only naval fighter plane in the Pacific theater, inflicting heavy losses on the more agile Japanese Zero. It was also the first American-built Navy fighter to destroy a German combat aircraft. Despite being stubby and a bit slow, the rugged Wildcat had an impressive kill-to-loss ratio, averaging 7-1 for the entire war.
My name's Greg Ward, and I'm the aircraft restoration manager here at the Air Zoo. We have a huge collection of airplanes. Some are owned by the Navy, the Air Force, the Army, and the remainder of the collection are privately owned airplanes owned by the Air Zoo.
Greg and his team of dedicated volunteers are working to add one more to the collection, an FM-2 Wildcat, the last of its kind built near the end of the war. They already have one FM-2 Wildcat, which was designed by the Grumman Aircraft Engineering Corporation, but built by General Motors. And while this Wildcat looks like it just rolled out of the factory, this one is a little worse for wear. Until recently, it had been sitting at the bottom of Lake Michigan for 68 years. Between 1942 and 45, more than 17,000 pilots trained on U.S. Navy carriers based on Lake Michigan. Unfortunately, not every plane nailed the landing. This Wildcat was recovered in 2012. Now it's being restored. Rebuilding is quite different from the first construction. The FM-2 Wildcat was built along a huge assembly line that snaked through a New Jersey factory employing 9,000 people by 1944. The staff at Air Zoo is more Spartan, just a few volunteers. An important rebuild is the engine. Dennis is a retired mechanic who's passionate about aviation engines. He's been working on this Wildcat for 4 years. Dennis is installing the number one cylinder, the top cylinder that sits at 12 o'clock to the pilot. The cylinders make up the power section of the engine. Holding the pistons, they're on the outside of the engine to draw heat away from it. Dennis slides the cylinder onto the piston and rings, then screws the spark plug in and attaches the ignition lead. FM-2 production was a gigantic undertaking. The Wildcat had 11,000 different parts made in 23 states and Canada. The final fuselage assembly took just 75 work hours. The fuselage on this FM-2 is missing parts of its tail, sheared off by the ship after it hit the water.
That's a huge undertaking to put it back together, but we're doing it as we speak.
The aluminum rib is placed around the bulkhead, a circular piece of plywood backing. The ribs are temporarily fitted to the bulkheads using clamps. The bulkheads hold the ribs' shape, but once the skin is rolled on, the bulkheads are discarded. These aluminum ribs will be refitted at least 10 times before they are permanently fixed into place. They'll form the rivet lines and boundary for new skin. Eventually, the Wildcat's entire fuselage will be riveted together like this one. Another Wildcat feature is the ability to fold its wings back, as seen on this fully restored plane. The Wildcat's prototype was the first aircraft to have functional folding wings. This innovation made more room on carrier decks, allowing the ship to store 50% more planes. The Air Zoo team is working hard to get this wing working again. When the plane crashed, it clipped the carrier, shredding its left wing. Greg is helping Dave reskin it. Dave once flew combat missions in Vietnam. Now he restores planes that have also flown some unfriendly skies. Temporary fasteners called clecos hold the aluminum skin in place. These tools are vintage, around since the 1940s.
The cleco pliers depress a spring, we put it in a hole and release it, and the cleco stays in the hole until we can rivet the wing back together again.
In the end, hundreds will be temporarily fastened. And when the wing is ready, they'll have to be taken out one by one.
I've gotten to the point in my life now where I pretty much have unlimited patience for these projects. You have to.
Greg and his team are going to need it. They've worked for 4 years so far, and it will be another 4 years before the plane is fully restored. In a show of industrial might that changed the course of the war, GM produced more than 5,000 Wildcats between 1942 and 1945. Very few are still able to take to the air.
There are probably 9 Wildcats licensed and flying now.
Greg is in for a rare treat. Pilot Mike Gillian is going to take a piece of history into the air.
I always get goosebumps when I hear those radial engines running. I can't help it. It's very exciting to see them in action.
The diddly-bow is the child of passion and poverty. When poor people needed an instrument, they would pull a wire across whatever they could find, from the side of a shack to a broom handle and cigar box. They'd play that string with a bow, a slide, a bottleneck, or a knife. The diddly bow and the cigar box guitar gave birth to the blues and changed modern American music forever.
My name's Kevin Edwards, and I own Guitar Gallery on the Square, where I build handcrafted cigar box guitars.
A hollow interior gives the instrument its resonance, but a good-looking cigar box gives the instrument style. The first order of business is to cut a hole for the neck.
I think you definitely want to go with a wood box if you're going to be doing an acoustic, for sure.
Cigars used to be delivered in barrels, but it was hard to monitor or tax their import. They were put into boxes in the 1800s, so they were easier to count. Next, Kevin notches the neck. This recessed wood will go inside the box.
We're gonna basically dado cut underneath the box lid to make sure we have a little bit of room between the box lid and the neck to allow for vibration.
That vibration creates the sound. After cutting off the bottom of the neck, it's time to work on the other end, where the tuning pegs will go. Kevin measures to make sure the center point is on the neck, not the cigar box. It allows the guitar to be played over 2 octaves.
Scientifically, the octave point is the halfway point of the string, which registers as the same note, but at a higher pitch. This gets you to your next octave, which is a really signature blues sound.
The neck is stained because this inexpensive instrument still needs to look slick. Kevin drills 3 holes in the top for the pegs and 3 in the bottom to secure the strings on the end sticking out of the box. Lightnin' Hopkins made a cigar box guitar using screen wire. Blind Willie Johnson started playing a 1-string box guitar at the age of 5, using a pocket knife as a slide. One of his songs is on the Golden Record, launched into space on the Voyager probe in 1977. The neck is secured to the guitar. After that, you need a bridge for the strings. Now it's time to string the instrument. The oldest illustration of a cigar box guitar dates back to 1876. Once the guitar is strung, you just have to tune it. Then you're good to go.